1986, the FBI was involved in an infamous shootout known as the Miami-Dade shooting between 8 agents and 2 bank robbers, or as I like to call it, the shootout between 4 agents and 1 bank robber. I won't get too deep into details, but to keep a long story short, the FBI agents involved in the shooting were not well equipped, carrying only 9mm handguns and 38 special revolvers. During the shootout, the true error was the marksmanship abilities of the agents involved. However, the FBI credited their failure to the potency of the Winchester silver tip rounds the FBI used at the time. This resulted in Smith & Wesson designing the FBI's dream gun, the Smith & Wesson Model 1076. Reportedly, some of the agents were not able to handle the sharp recoil of the guns, causing the FBI to download the 10mm cartridge. The loaded down cartridge is known as the FBI load. Because the round was reduced in power, it tended to cause reliability issues with the guns. This resulted in the creation of the 40 Smith & Wesson cartridge we all know of today. The Model 1006 was the first in the 1000 series of Smith & Wesson's third generation semi-automatic handguns, and it's considered the flagship model. Variations include the Model 1026, 1046, 1066, 1076, which is often referred to as the FBI model, and the 1086. The 1000 series were some of the most robust, sturdy, and durable 10mm handguns ever built, easily handling the power of the potent cartridge. All guns were made entirely of stainless steel and featured a 9-round single-stack magazine. The Model 1006 was a double single-action pistol with a slide-mounted safety decocker, spurt hammer, and 5-inch barrel. The 1006 shipped with adjustable sights or fixed Novak sights. The rest of the pistols featured bobbed hammers and fixed Novak sights only. The total number of 1006 pistols produced was 26,978. The Model 1026 was a double single-action pistol featuring a SIG-style frame-mounted decocker and a 5-inch barrel. The total number of this pistol produced was 3,135. The Model 1046 was a double-action-only pistol featuring a slightly shortened length of pull and a 5-inch barrel. The total number of this pistol produced was 151, making it the most rare pistol in the series. The Model 1066 was a double single-action pistol with a slide-mounted safety decocker and a 4.25-inch barrel. The total number of this pistol produced was 5,067. The Model 1076 was the pistol Smith & Wesson produced for the FBI. It was a double single-action pistol featuring a SIG-style frame-mounted decocker and a 4.25-inch barrel. The pistols produced for the FBI did not feature a magazine disconnect, unlike the other pistols in the series. This feature can be easily removed on any third-generation Smith & Wesson pistol, which I will discuss later. The total number of 1076 pistols produced was 13,805. Finally, the last of the series was the Model 1086, a double-action-only pistol with a slightly shortened length of trigger pull and a 4.25-inch barrel. The total number of this pistol produced was 1,660. Because of the barrel lengths, I like to think of the 1006, 1026, and 1046 as the equivalent of the government Model 1911, while the 1066, 1076, and 1086 represent the Commander 1911. Sadly, the 1000 series was very short-lived, being produced only from 1990 to 1996. The guns fed from a single-stack magazine holding 9 rounds, giving them a very slim grip. Another neat feature is that because of this little lip on the magazine, the 10mm magazines could not be confused with the 45 ACP magazines used in the 4500 series. Smith & Wesson pistols have a reputation for being extremely reliable, and this remains to be the truth even to this day. I've put several hundred rounds through this gun with absolutely zero malfunctions. I can promise you this gun is just as reliable as a Glock. The guns shipped from Smith & Wesson with these straight backstrap grips. However, curved backstrap grips such as these are available to purchase at Midway USA. Smith & Wesson even produced a palm swell grip for the 1026 and 1076, which I prefer to any other of the factory grips. As well, Hoag also produced several aftermarket grips for the guns, both being rubberized or wooden. The stock Smith & Wesson grips are very thin and can be a problem for people with bigger hands. The grips offered by Hoag give you a much more beefy and comfortable grip. Though a wide variety of holsters are still produced for this gun, it can sometimes be difficult to find the one right for you, considering the gun hasn't been produced in over 22 years. Two of my favorite holsters are the Bianchi Model 105, which I've slightly modified to where it doesn't have the little retention strap, and the Model 518 by Safariland. Night sights can be purchased for both the adjustable sight models and Novak sight models, and there are plenty of aftermarket holsters for the guns if you know what you want and where to look. I'd say your best bet for aftermarket parts would probably be Midway USA. They have tons of holsters as well as replacement parts should you ever need them, and aftermarket grips. As well, I'd like to throw in that earlier Smith & Wesson guns came in a little cardboard blue box, while later guns, such as mine, came in this really nice heavy-duty polymer box.
It features these really nice latches, and the inside features some nice padding. Here is where the two magazines that the gun came with were stored, while the other one was stored inside the gun. And this is the compartment where the gun lock and papers are stored.
All right, safety sallies, the gun is now empty. Now, disassembly and reassembly of the guns is very simple. It utilizes the Browning high power design, the really simple, easy to take apart. So what you do first is pull back on the slide until it meets the slide catch. Then going to the other side, there's a little pin over here that you need to push out. It's this one right here. Once it's to this point, you can just remove it. Then return the slide to the front position. Whenever the slide comes forward, it will drop the hammer, so just really carefully guide it into place, and then slide comes apart from the frame. So the recoil spring is not captive, unlike most modern guns. So whenever you're taking it apart, do be very careful. I've had it launch across the room on me several times, all of which were very embarrassing. So recoil spring and guide rod are not connected. They come apart so that you can maintain them more easily. And then the barrel just lifts out of the gun. My only gripe with the gun is that whenever you're reassembling it, you have to make sure the guide rod latches into this little notch right here, which is part of the reason why I've had so many recoil springs launch across the room on me. When you're reassembling the gun, make sure that you don't jam the ejector into the back of the slide. That happens a lot of the times to people who are inexperienced. So when reassembling it, just push it down, push the slide over it, and then use your nail to depress these. Just do a function check, and you're back in action. One of my favorite Ebomey quotes is, "The gun is now loaded and I feel safe." A lot of people ask me why I choose the 10.06 over any other 10mm gun like a Glock 20, and the answer is quite simple. The Glock 20, though reliable, feels like a 2x4 in your hand. It's as well known to be one of the more fragile 10mm handguns, experiencing cracked frames very often. Initially, I considered the model 1076 because I was intrigued by the fact that it was what the FBI carried for a brief period of time, but after seeing the 1006, I just fell in love. Not only is the 1006 reliable, but it's also the most beautiful pistol I've ever seen. It has all the features I looked for whenever I selected it for my 10mm handgun, including the placement of the safety decocker, a spurred hammer, and a single stack magazine. The gun is hefty, however it's extremely comfortable to carry in my opinion. Besides, the heft of these guns is what made them manage the recoil of 10mm so well. I've shot many 10mm pistols in my time and none other handles the 10mm like the 1006 does. This is a pistol you can carry to hell and back and I can almost guarantee it'll fire every single time you pull the trigger. Speaking of the trigger, I will do a trigger pull demonstration, and don't worry, the gun is unloaded yet again, and I don't feel safe. That's the magazine, and the chamber is empty, as you can see. The gun's double action trigger pull is about 11 pounds, while the gun's single action trigger pull is about 4 pounds. As with most double action, single action pistols, this gun does take a little bit of time to master. The double action is a very smooth but heavy trigger pull, while the single action is a very crisp break. As you can see, there's just that little bit of take up, and then it snaps. And the reset is just right there. The only true problems the pistols ever experienced that were not related to overly light ammunition were the original one-piece plastic grips. The grip I have here is one of the newer grips, which has a channel taken out of the back, but the original ones did not feature this. Reportedly, the original grips would crack if the guns were dropped on the heel, causing the mainspring to fly free. Customers who contacted Smith & Wesson were sent replacement grips, no charge. As aforementioned, the older grips did not feature this little channel out of the back of the grip, they were just flush. The Model 1076 also found favor with the Kentucky State Police for a number of years, and the Virginia State Police carried the Model 1026 from 1990 to 1994. Though I don't believe the Virginia State Police ever carried the 1076, Smith & Wesson did promote the pistol for them. Both the 1026 and 1076 were promoted for the Virginia State Police, and models which were promoted feature a slide with a mirror finish. I'm not exactly sure why this is, but the models they did carry featured the standard stainless finish. Any guns that were actually carried by the Virginia State Police were capable of firing with the magazine removed and are marked as such. In the early 90s, there were 650 Model 1006 pistols that were custom made for the Highway Patrol. On the right side of the slide, they're marked California Highway Patrol Limited Edition and one of 650. I'd like to designate a special segment of this review to the Model 1076, as there is much controversy and confusion surrounding this specific pistol. Though I wouldn't go as far as to call myself an expert, I've certainly done my research on these pistols. Now, the difference between the FBI pistols and the civilian pistols are often overlooked. The FBI ordered the pistols without a magazine disconnect, and those without it should be specifically marked with a warning. As well, the FBI pistols featured a different checkering pattern on the front strap of the grip, while the civilian pistols featured the standard line markings. The FBI pistols were mandatorily equipped with tritium night sights. 1076 pistols carried by the Kentucky State Police will feature the KSP emblem on the right side of the slide and feature a special serial number beginning with KSP. When the FBI issued the 1076, they were issued 3 9-round magazines, 2 11-round magazines, and 2 15-round magazines. Though extremely rare, these 15-round magazines can still be found and purchased to this day. Another interesting thing to note is that Hogue never produced any aftermarket grips for the 1026 and 1076. However, a simple and easy modification can be made for the grips to accommodate the pistols. This is great for people who have a hard time holding onto the pistols with the stock grips. Now, you're probably asking, what are my impressions of the 1006? I'll be completely honest, I think this is one of the best pistols ever designed, and without a doubt, the best 10mm pistol ever designed. It combines beauty with ultra-reliability and has to be one of the most, if not the most, durable handguns ever built. This specific 1006 is my holy grail gun, and quite frankly, it'll never leave my collection. I highly recommend it to those who are experienced, however, it's not for everyone. I hope you all enjoyed the video. If you would, please leave a like and tell me what you thought about it in the comments section below. I always read the comments. As always, thanks for watching, stay safe, and God bless.